event. If you're here, I don't need to tell you much about Frances Mays. Her accounts of the voluptuousness of Italian life have enchanted and inspired us. The world of small-town Georgia, Frances's childhood home, is recreated in her latest works. In all of her writing, Frances Mays has shown herself to be a master of the sensuous, depicting the sights, sounds, smells, and especially tastes that make a place unique and memorable. Please join me in welcoming Frances Mays.
Thank you. Just going to kind of Lord. It's wonderful to be here. We just drove down from North Carolina. Today is such a beautiful drive, even though we got a speeding ticket. And it's really wonderful to be here. This is my third time in Abingdon. It's just beautiful. It's a lovely town. I came here maybe 2 years ago to see Good Old Girls at the theater, because Lee Smith's my neighbor in Hillsboro, and so we came here to, that was really fun, to stay at the marker and to see that. And then my wine, which you've been drinking, debuted in Virginia at Steve Smith's grocery stores, and so we came down for some wine events around that. It was really fun. So we just want to come back sometime when we can go bicycling and hiking, and this looks like just a wonderful place for an event, and I just can't tell you how lucky you are to have so many good restaurants. It doesn't happen a lot, you know. So it's just great to be here. I want to thank everyone who had a hand in organizing this, and thank you all for coming. And I'm going to talk about place as a kind of locus for writing and how it has been so important in my work. As you know, I've written many books about Italy. We went to Italy first in 1990. Seems impossible by now, but we bought a house then. We were pioneers in a way, because now you hear about people going to Tuscany a lot and renting houses or buying houses, but then no one did that, and we were crazy. It was foolish, it was wild, but it was one of the best things I've ever done. So that the sense of place around Tuscany, and the sense of place I had growing up in South Georgia, Fitzgerald, Georgia, have been very important in defining subject matter for me and just kind of orientation on the earth. My memoir came out about a year and a half ago. It's called Under Magnolia, which connects to Under the Tuscan Sun, kind of this under the influence of a place. When the memoir came out, I was surprised. All the reviews that started coming out said this is about Frances Mays and her dysfunctional family. We weren't dysfunctional, we were just Southern. I think both places, the South and Tuscany, are very formative landscapes. They are formative in that living there, you begin to feel kind of a shaping power coming to you from the place. In the oldest creation myths, the gods formed humans out of mud and kind of slapped them into shape. And I feel that way kind of about place, that it's, you are of that mud and you will become of that place. I wondered as I was writing the memoir why anyone would do that. I was compelled myself, but I thought it was kind of a strange venture. At the same time, if you're not a world changer, you're just a person with your normal ups and downs and triumphs and disasters, why do you want to take such a kind of big swan dive into the past? you have to know that everybody around you is going to grimace. They are not going to be thrilled that you're writing about your life unless you're willing to put a big whitewash over the kind of lesser aspects of what the family was up to. You have to ask, will they, if you're truthful, will they even speak to you? Most people don't have impeccable families where nothing has ever gone wrong, but most people in families, if there's a writer in the family, they would like for you to present it as if nothing was ever wrong. Of course, that would be a very boring book. But I did ask myself a lot, why go there? You're risking a really bad scene at Thanksgiving. But I came up with several answers, partly because I was so compelled to do it myself. And one is that, you know, your life is precious. The instant someone dies, their spirit goes out the window and so much else is lost at the same time. I found out that I had ancestors who came from Ireland. It was a priest and a nun who ran away together. Wouldn't I like to have her journey from her journal, from her journey across the Atlantic to here? We know nothing about these people. It would be such a great thing to have a whole inheritance of writing from your family, no matter, you know, what they did. I had a great-grandfather who started cotton mills in Gastonia, North Carolina. I didn't even know about that part of the family because my grandfather had had a big split with his father and never spoke of him. So when I moved back to North Carolina a few years ago, I discovered this enormous past that was part of me that I had no idea of. Even my own grandparents, I never really thought to ask them very much. When I was a child, very little remains from that time. Someone in North Carolina gave me a poem that my great-great-grandfather had written. It was not Walt Whitman or anything, but I was so thrilled to find out that someone else in my family had had the impulse to pick up the pen. It was just such a nice link. So I think all those things it really influenced me in deciding to write the book. I found several letters my father wrote to my mother when they were first married, and then marriage was just chaotic, and it was, I've written all about it in my book, but I read these letters, and one of them ended, "I love you with worship." And I suddenly got this glimpse of a man that I didn't know. So these written documents, I think they're very, very crucial, and so it's important to do it. I thought, you know, somebody in the future may be interested in this, but you never know in the future whether they'll care or not. And what do you owe to vague descendants? They may or may not. So I think it's just mainly from a sense of personal satisfaction that you want to disturb the past, even when some of it is cooling off rather nicely by now. I think the great benefit of writing memoir is that you begin to see your life in a wider perspective. You just tend to go through your life day by day, month by month, year by year, but when you start writing about it, the whole context of it opens up, and the people in your past become more set in their own terms, not just the way you experienced them yourself as you were growing up. You start to think how their lives would differ if it weren't for you. And how you struggle to be as much without them as you struggle to be with them. It's very powerful terrain to cross. It feels like kind of if you've got a little tiny gold chain and it's gotten knotted and you're trying to separate the knots with little pins and then finally it comes loose and the little pendant falls down. It feels like that often when you're writing memoir. I think the other great thing about writing in memoir is that you get to give life to your memory again. I can once more feel my graduation pearls coming unstrung on the floor of the Central Methodist Church while the choir sang Jerusalem. I can again baptize my protesting dog. So you get to relive your life in a vivid way, a vividness coming through the words, through the language. So you get to see them all around you again, everyone in your past, seated at dinner, wondering what's for dessert, coconut cake, pecan pie, fighting over the wishbone. They all return. They are recreated on paper. And when you do that, if you have any ghosts that you would like to expel, it's a good way to do it by writing memoir, because those who are gone, they sometimes roost on your shoulder, but when you write about them and you place them in a narrative, they fly off and they settle down in a very high nest and they go to sleep. You haven't tamed them, but by calling them by name and putting them in the story, they assume a place from which they cannot roam your mind so easily anymore. In writing, my passions are image and place. I love to try to recreate in words what has happened, to make it so that it is alive twice. A Chinese poet said, to make an image is to live twice. And I have always lived by that. I think it's true for me as a writer. If I get to try to create a particular place or person, loving the sensory visual world, that's what drives me to pick up the pen. Under Magnolia takes place on the cusp of civil rights. We were ignorant. We were, as they did before the invention of wheels, we were rolling our stones on logs, and we had yet to invent the wheel at that time. We had yet to join the wide world through television and cyberspace. I grew up in a town of 10,000 people. It was a beautiful small town, a green terrarium, as I think of it now. There was one road in and one road out, as my mother used to say. She'd say, we're south of everywhere. And now, every time somebody has a flat tire in Patagonia, we know about it. But then, the news was distant. We were in a world, and living in a city most of my adult life, I know how people refer to places like that as the backwoods or the flyover places. So one reason I wanted to write that book was to show the passionate, important lives of people in a place like that, and to give life to a kind of time and place. I initially began the memoir because my daughter, who was raised in California, loved the family stories. When she was about five or six, we went to a wedding in Georgia, and it was a whole kind of big Southern wedding, and she was kind of amazed by everything she saw. And she, at some point during one of the endless parties, she pulled on my skirt and said, how do you talk without saying anything? But she grew up loving my family and the stories of my family, even the painful ones. It was an exciting process to write the memoir. It starts off slowly, and then after a while you feel like you're just holding on to a horse that's bolted out of the barn. Oddly enough, I found that my sense of place came to be more vividly experienced when I first moved to Italy. I grew up reading Southern writers, a new sense of place. I absorbed sense of place like you do cheese grits and smothered quail. But when I got to Italy, it was really the shock of a different culture that kind of polished the lens on my native culture. And as I stayed long enough in Italy, I started to feel the power of that place and how it began to change me. So that was a really big revelation and kind of a changing point in my writing. It was also when I changed from writing poetry to writing prose. Started under the Tuscan Sun, I'm about to buy a house in a foreign country. And that house, which is situated beneath an Etruscan wall and a Medici wall, it became home, it became more than home, it became the heart's needle, the center of my private universe. It has an apricot and rose shuttered facade. It faces south. It has profuse geraniums and clematis and lemons and lavender. It has a very burgeoning garden. The soil there is something like chocolate cake. I've never seen soil like that. You throw a few seeds out and the next day they're over the house. It's just a very fertile place. And I think that's why all the vegetables taste so good there. It was, to me at that time, buying the house, it was exotic. The house itself symbolized to me this change I was making in my life. It symbolized not the life I was given, but the life I was going to make with my own two hands. Opening my study window in those first few years and leaning out into the bright air, I could see the garden below. I could just about name every plant and say hello to each one. I listened to the musical notes cascading into the ancient cistern. I saw the lilacs, the dahlias, the lilies, and several secret reading spots among the olives. It seemed dreamy. It seemed almost surreal. Across the top terrace, hundreds of giant sunflowers hold court in July. They're my little marching band of glorious faces. By August, they bow over and they look like a lot of rusty shower heads where you don't want to really take a shower. Inside the house, I have my books, my collections of religious folk art, ceramic platters, old linens, and by now, boxes and boxes of manuscripts in innumerable crossed out, underlined, and scrawled drafts. My rooms are like fingerprints, and Ed's wild study looks down on the chaotic desk, the cool white bedroom with the linen curtains, the kitchen where the pottery hangs on white walls, the dining room, which holds so many memories of feasts with friends under the faded blue and white fresco we discovered long ago. The house lives powerfully on its own, and we feel powerfully alive within its walls. In a dream, I was given an ultimatum. I had a choice of selling Bramasole or losing my arm. The power broker of this dilemma had the face of the Randolph-Macon academic dean who told me sophomore year that I could buckle down and take the required courses, economics and physiology, she mentioned, or leave the college. Now she stood in front of my best-beloved apricot claret house, waving a hacksaw. House or arm, make a choice. I woke clutching my right wrist, my writing hand. I'd fully experienced that for me, that choice was impossible. I'd been head over heels in love with that odd set of simple rooms overlooking a tender valley. The Renaissance painters knew these valleys as they passionately recreated scenes just beyond the Annunciation, just beyond the angels, or the martyrs riddled with arrows? Where does the desire to live in a place not your own come from? My family is fond of saying that when I was 18, I took the first thing smoking on the runway out of Georgia. They forget that in our hometown there was no runway. My grandfather said, you can go anywhere you want to college, as long as it's not north of the Mason-Dixon line. I made it as far as Virginia. I was already dreaming of European avenues with chestnuts in bloom, of the wavy colored reflections in the Grand Canal, and most of all, of the dry attic air of Greece, where even the wind might seem to blow ancient sighs of the oracle. In my senior notebook in high school, from the required reading, The Old Man and the Sea, I wrote only one sentence. I have seen the lions on the beach at evening. I imagined the colors of the sand and the light glancing off the water, and of tawny animals cuffing each other and tumbling. The whole image rose in my mind as though I actually had seen those lions pacing the tide line in Africa. I had a longing to go, just go, go, go. Who knows where such innate impulses come from? But they're strong, and they should be obeyed because they come to define who you are. I think the lions on the beach at evening eventually landed me on the brink of a major life change. I looked up at the Tuscan house from the car, and I said, I want this house, even though I had seen the inside. I had no idea what a disaster it was. Now that house has given me 9 books. When I bought Bramasole, the house seemed so at home on the land that I thought if I lived there, I would be at home too. I was scrambling to reinvent my life after a divorce. I'd always loved Italy, the landscape, the art, the cuisine, the culture. And I thought to myself, Italy, it's 1,000 lifetimes deep. Surely it's a substitute for just one man. Gradually over the years, I restored the place. As that happened, my writing life expanded. The poetry I wrote refused to fall into lines. I didn't know how to do the line breaks anymore. Every day, the life in such a new old place took over the rhythms in my brain, and the lines grew longer and longer into paragraphs and chapters. I didn't will this. The place made it happen. The townspeople were very happy to see Bramasole occupied, although they initially thought, you must be crazy to take this place that's been abandoned for 30 years. The house is on a road where local people take their passeggiata. And when we were first cleaning out the junk and spiders, the people taking their walks would call up to us from the road and say, how much did you pay? And we'd say, probably too much. And then they'd say, are you German? And we'd say, no. And they would say, grazie Santa Maria. We learned at that point something about Italian time, that World War II was just yesterday. I mean, having grown up in Georgia, I'm used to talk about the war between the states and that my dead grandmother could walk in the door at any minute. But in Italy, it's back to Hannibal. You go to someone's house for dinner and they're talking about, did Hannibal come from the east, and did he have one elephant? Had he lost his eye by then? Anything Hannibal? But he defeated the Romans in 217 BC, just below in the valley. But he could be riding up for dessert on one of those elephants. As the local people walked by, we heard their conversations, and ravioli, ciliegi, insalata del campo, all kinds of pasta references, melone, it was food. I said to Ed, do these people think about nothing but food. And now we join them, that's all we think about. Food, I mean, it turns out to be this central cultural metaphor for understanding Italy, what they value. What else besides how people bury their dead is so revealing as how food is served, where it comes from, who's at the table, what the dynamic is, the whole kind of philosophy around food and the table is so revealing. It was quite mad at the time, but often I think it turns out that irrational decisions you make that come from some deep instinct, they're often the best moves you make in your life. All the friends and relatives who told me I was crazy, that I was stepping on the path to ruin, are now frequent guests. And they often speak about how they always thought it was a brilliant idea. That is a place 7,000 miles from home. So many profound aspects of life in Tuscany at that point begin to seep into my skin. The restoration was perpetual discovery, still a lot of discovery. After 25 years, we still discover things. You dig up something in the garden, a beautiful little pattern of pottery, or some kind of piece of iron that was used in farming. I just hope I never dig up any of those German mines that were buried all over Tuscany. When we were first there, we were scrubbing down the dining room wall just in order to repaint it. It was whitewashed. And this kind of scumbled blue began to emerge. And we kept scrubbing it with sponges, and there was water everywhere. And this lovely fresco emerged, and we thought, this is a miracle. We discovered a fresco. We knew it wasn't Piero della Francesca or anything, but it was a beautiful rendering of the local landscape that we could see from the end of our land. Well, one of the workers, because he took so much for granted, this fresco, because anytime you scrub in Cortona, you find the fresco, it turned out. But we didn't know that at the time, and he took a Sharpie and he wrote his boss's telephone number in the blue sky above the fresco. And we were just absolutely furious, and I couldn't believe he had done this, but over the years, the plumber's number has come in handy. We brought the land back to its ancient production. We've discovered that the old stone sink of the house was buried in the garden, and when we lifted this stone sink out, below it, there was this declivity in the stone and a beautiful spring at the bottom. So then we knew why the house had been built there. There was the water supply. So many discoveries, hundreds of secret hilltop villages, the whole history of the Etruscans, which was not that well known to me at the time, the futurists, the history, the people. I think I keep falling in love more and more every day I've ever spent there. The biggest challenge of living in Italy we found was learning a new language. When you learn after the age of 6, I think, I'm not totally sure, but when you learn as an adult, the new language takes place in a whole different part of your brain from where your languages you learned as a small child take place. So as we've learned, we can feel that kind of journey over the frozen tundra, you know, from the original language center. Initially, we went to Italian lessons in a palazzo in Cortona. And outside, on the way, there's an antique shop where there's a minor bird in the cage. And we had been studying all day with our little books that taught us how to say have you washed yourself well, or have you been to see if the barometer has fallen, or sir, you have insulted me, I demand satisfaction. These useless things that we have in this book. We dressed this minor bird in a cage, and the bird would say to us, chow, like that. Not chow, chow, which is the exact local chomped on kind of inflection of chow. They don't say chow. And I said to Ed, that bird has a better accent than we do. We will never learn Italian. But it's been a fabulous adventure learning a new language. I studied French and German and Spanish through the years. None of it ever really took very well. But when you're living in a place and you have to learn a language, it's totally different. So Ed and I, both being writers, love words, the sound of words. We often started using words that we didn't even know what they meant just because we liked the sound of them. And one of those words was galleggiante. It's a great word. It sounds like elegant. It sounds just like you want to say, this beautiful work of art is so galleggiante, or Ed would say to me, you're looking so galleggiante this evening. So it was a word we used a lot, but one day the toilet was running and running and running, and you know, the tanks are up top in European toilets usually, and Ed stood up and pushed the little ball down, and the noise stopped. So we went to the hardware building supply store, and, you know, there's no way to look up floating ball inside toilet, but we did our little charade and drawing things to the clerk there, and he said, oh, you want a galleggiante. Since we learned Italian, more or less, we take a lot of perverse pleasure in watching other people who have come after us there try to learn the language. And one incident that I really loved was this American woman who comes there frequently, and she's a purist with her food. She wants nothing with any kind of pesticides or everything organic. She was in front of me at the little kind of deli counter, and she was talking to Claudio, and she said she wanted her prosciutto senza preservativo. And I saw him just take a step back almost and try not to laugh. And then she's out the door, and he says to me that she has asked for her prosciutto without a condom. Because it happens to everybody. I mean, I've asked for a fish when I wanted a peach. I mean, I've asked for a horse when I wanted a cabbage. The words are similar. And the Italians are so nice. They don't really make you feel like you're too much of a fool. So I have been ravaged by the Italian ability to enjoy food. They serve forth such amazing, but usually very simple food. They have a celebration at the table. There's no kind of psychological torturing around eating, which I really love there. In all my years there, I've never heard food connected once with guilt. I always thought sinful and dessert went together, but you just don't hear any psychological struggles around food there. I think instead the relaxation around food is extraordinary. I didn't catch on to it quite at first. We would invite Italians to our house to dinner, and sometimes they would turn up with two extra people, and I was just totally flummoxed by that. You never do that here, unless you called and said, my cousin's in town or whatever. But I began to understand it later as that relaxation around the table. What's the big deal? You throw on another hand of pasta, you pull up another chair, and that's just the way it is. I think it's just a kind of real symbol of their value of friendship and hospitality in the way that things can spontaneously happen. If you are out with your neighbor picking asparagus, wild asparagus, you're immediately invited over to make a frittata. There's just a lot of spontaneity around food, and I think the under message of that is that you start to learn to live by the seasons rather than the clock. Everyone is out. At this time of year, we're just about to go back for the olive harvest, and everyone will be hunting the porcini mushrooms right now. It's just that time of year. Each season has its pleasures, and I felt it moving into my books as well. I found that I began to let my subjects take me rather than to be overly determining about a direction of where my writing might be going. The olive harvest, which is Ed's favorite time of year, it's an ancient ritual. It culminates in going to the mill and then coming home with this great, lovely, greeny, fresh, pungent oil that transforms your kitchen. To me, nothing is as important in the kitchen as a good olive oil. You feel like people go out to a restaurant and they spend $40-$50 on a bottle of wine and it's gone immediately. But they won't spend anything like that on olive oil, which lasts a long time in the kitchen and is a totally transforming act in the food that you make. It's just the best investment you can make in your kitchen. The olive, it's not just that it's great to cook with, but it's kind of something that connects you with the root of life, particularly Mediterranean life. That same thing with the grape. When we bought our house, it was so full of wine bottles, we thought, gosh, these people were really alcoholics. This is unbelievable. We were throwing out all these wine bottles. But when we cleared the land, we found out that it had once been a vineyard. And finally, we made wine with Beppe's help. He helps us on the land. And we only got 12 bottles. Vines had to be tended for 3 or 4 years before they yielded anything again. So we were totally thrilled, and we prepared a feast. We had 12 bottles of Bramasole wine. We had returned the place to its original function. So Ed got out the big Brunello glasses. We made a 7-hour leg of lamb. I made strawberry roulade. We invited our neighbors over. And Ed poured the wine and everybody, chin chin, chin chin. And then there was this expression on everybody's face. It was the worst wine ever been made in Tuscany. Our neighbor said to Ed, how many of these did you say you had? Ed said 12, and he said, I think that's 11 too many. This wine that you've been drinking has nothing to do with that. Writing these books on Italy, as I said, was what made me really realize how we are changed by place. What caught me originally in Tuscany, I think what made it seem so much like falling in love, I go back over and over to this house that is so at home on the side of this hill. It's been wedged into time. It's in a continuum of time. And it symbolizes to me how the Italians are so at home in time that it has given me that sense of being a part of a continuum in time in a way that I never experienced before. The house is, your house is your location for your most sublime moments. It's the location for your creativity. It's your buffer between you and the wolf. The foundation of the house touches the earth, and whatever spirits abide in the earth rise through the walls and right into your life. A house, I think, if I think of it in the most poetic way I can, a house is a book. and you have to ask about your house, what kind of book is it? And I think for me, that house, inside that house, I think it has to be a book of poems. I realized that the Italian word for room is stanza. So it has seemed to me, living in that house, it's almost like living inside a poem. I feel in that house as though I'm held in a large hand. It's the naturalness of stone, open arched windows, the silence you float in at night. It gives you a new sensation. I felt as if I were home, really home. How strange that is to experience in a country not your own. I felt like a small boat raised and lowered by the tides. I was buoyed and rocked by the rhythms of deep country life. Time, to be wedged in time in that place, in that house, is a great gift, and it was worth any risk. Tuscany had its way with me as my hometown, Fitzgerald, Georgia, had its indelible way with me. The place you can recognize as yours, only yours. I think it's a really lucky connection. The ways I changed, and many of my friends and family too, are very easy to recognize. I think people who own so much time, feel that much comfort in time, feel that time is a river. It's a river for floating. Our friends get their work done, but they don't obsess by it. They drop in, they call, they propose spontaneous trips. They stay out late having dinner on Wednesday night. We hardworking Americans fight time, ring time out, push up against time, clock ourselves constantly, check that email over and over. Italians relish the seasons and the special joys of each. The spring means you're hunting green almonds and brand new nettles. In the fall, out come the baskets for the chestnuts and the truffles. The seasons connect you to the abiding beauties of nature. What a gift as a writer. I abandoned my self-set deadlines and wrote only when I wanted to. There, sleeping with the door open, waking with the splendiferous Tuscan dawns, listening to the bees mining the linden, lying in the grass at night, watching the falling stars, walking to town instead of driving, all this strengthened my love of the world. I let more sky, paths, trees, stars, bees, stones, rain into my books. As indoors and outdoors became more seamless, I got back that thrilling feeling I had on summer nights in the long twilights of Georgia summer, when all the neighborhood children played kick the cans in the alleys and hide and seek among the bridal wreath bushes and the old mother gardenias. When the mothers began to call, often we pretended not to hear. We were on the cusp of night in soft southern air, held in that air as though we belonged to the place itself, and not to the lighted houses with mothers outlined in doorways. I came to understand that the place you choose will form you and will make you what you are to become. Living among Italians, I came to relish days of solitude, casting about in art books, writing 30 sentences a day, some that could open a novel, reading a book a day, trying to find the exact word for the blonde light that fell through my studio window, listing good new words in my notebook, even visiting each rose in the garden, making crepes filled with spinach and ricotta, hiking on country roads, dolce far niente, the Italians say, sweet to do nothing, asking what informs, what inspires, what feeds, what amuses. Such days deeply refresh. When you do what you know how to do too many times, it's useful to try to unlearn, shake up the compass, and veer off into other territory. if you come back to what you were doing, usually it's with new insight. Learning about another culture provokes so many changes. I'm fascinated to the core to learn how fundamentally different Italy is, to learn that the world is not small. They are not like us. I am so happy for that. Beppe, who helps us in the garden, buries the grape tendril in such a way that it shoots out new growth. I recognize that easily as a metaphor for the way that life must change from time to time if we're going to go forward in our thinking. How to go forward is essentially the question that opens the Divine Comedy. You get to that lost spot in the woods and you figure your way out. Living in a foreign country shapes you to the core, and I think that's a very positive thing because we're creatures of our culture. We tend to vote the way our peers do, value what those near us value, worship and eat and dress in pretty much the same way close to home. Sometimes we can't truly see our lives because the background absorbs us into it. To leap out of all that changes you drastically, and perhaps it allows you to graze truths that you did not know you knew. In addition, the change of a different culture gave us a chance to have the gorgeous gift to live among the Tuscans and know how they learned to live like the gods. When you look back on crucible moments in your life, you see how each major change burned up something and created the ashes from which something bigger emerged. And many small changes amount to revolutionary changes if they give you your time back, your focus back, your priorities back. Act in the little ways that encourage good fortune, the poet William Stafford advised. Now I'm almost through and I'm looking forward to chatting. I think we'll have time for questions. But I just want to return for a moment to the Tuscan table, because that's the main symbol to me of friendship, a balanced life, and playing fun. And it's also kind of a motif for the way I would like for my writing life to exist. It's maybe you've accepted an invitation to a dinner in Tuscany. It's a table laden with the best food, wine that tastes of the Tuscan sun. But in Tuscany, dinner is never only dinner. Often it seems to me that a pact exists among the guests. Everyone will shine. Everyone will ensure that others are cosseted, flattered. The intimate society of diners creates this bond over and over. There's the table laden with the best food, crowded with friends to play musical chairs throughout the evening so that everyone gets to visit with each other, who may sing or play cards, get up to dance, even smoke those awful stubby cigars. The butcher may leap on the table and begin reciting Dante. Someone may fire a shotgun into the air. A dog will graze among the legs. Someone may shout out a proposal of marriage. You never know what will happen in the course of a big night under the stars. You may, as I did, even find yourself belting out Unchained Melody into a karaoke night. When the ordinary leaps beyond the ordinary, you follow. The table, it is the table, it is the book that remains set for the best life has to offer. La casa aperta, the open house. That's the philosophy, a good one for all, especially for a writer. And doors, windows and doors, therefore the mind. Let the butterflies and lizards and neighborhood cats have the run of the place. Shoes off, eyes wide open, pull up the extra chair at the table for the stranger. Fall into the round of giving melons, beans, figs all summer, and expect to be surprised. Delight, joy, excitement, surprise. These are the words for guiding, writing, and living. And then flip side, a trust in your instincts. Occhi tutti aperti, eyes wide open. My thoughts always are magnetized by these words. We were amazed to find that we could start making friends even before we could speak the language. Rita, at the fruit and vegetable shop, began saving little lettuces to us and greeting us with a hug. We couldn't even talk to her, but she became a friend. At the same time, our neighbor Placido came over and invited us to dinner. We had seen parties at his house, and we knew they lasted 6 to 8 hours. We couldn't speak Italian, and we did not want to go because we couldn't even say pass the wine. So we, you know, imagine these hours of halting words, and we said to him, grazie, grazie, mille, ma non parliamo italiano bene. Can you ask us later? We don't speak Italian. And he looked at us incredulously, and his eyebrows flew up, and he said, well, you eat, don't you? Thank you very much. When I agreed to have Touchstone make the movie, I knew that they would be doing a whole lot of changes to the book, because my book is rather quiet, and you know, we have to have a lot of action on the big screen. So I was fine with the changes they made and really enjoyed the whole process. Diane Lane was lovely. When the movie came out, my publisher issued a new copy of Under the Tuscan Sun, and it had her picture on the cover. And a lot of my friends were very cruel. They said, Frances, that's such a good picture. And she was darling. She's been back to Cortona several times. I was worried at first because I didn't know what it would be like when 27 moving vans of equipment and scraggly people working on the movie invaded this town, which is 1,500 people within the ancient walls. But I needn't have worried. They took it quite in stride. I said to Ed, I guess they've seen barbarian invasions. The only thing that really came up that was initially a problem, which turned out to be okay, was that Touchstone built a fountain in the middle of town in the piazza. And I was in the piazza one morning and I heard this English tour guide pointing out the Etruscan buildings and the Renaissance buildings around, and she said, and this is Cortona's Baroque fountain. It was made out of fiberglass. I guess that they had done a pretty good job, but it was an Atlas figure. He was holding up a big shell, the water coming off the shell. He was big, nude, huge. Huge in all of his parts. And some of the older people in Cortona took exception. They didn't think it was very dignified, so they went to the mayor. And the next morning when I was in the piazza, I saw the Touchstone people out there with the saw. So that all calmed down. And after that, everyone loved the fountain. And of course, it was dismantled at the end of the movie and is gone forever, and everybody misses it. And it's kind of interesting because a couple of years after that, somebody gave me an old print of Cortona from the early 1800s, and in that spot there had once been a fountain. So I think that's kind of thing, some things are really, you know, way back in memory that you do respond to. But I really liked the movie, and I've been amazed by Under the Tuscan Sun. It came out 20 years ago next year, and it's in 54 languages. We had people coming from all over the world to Cortona. And, you know, I always think it's nothing to do with me. It's you write a book, it goes out into the world, it develops its own life, and you just kind of watch it, and there it goes. In the movie, the same way, people come from all over. It's become kind of a cult movie. A lot of people have said to me, I hate that movie. And then a lot of people have said to me, I've seen that movie 100 times. It's interesting, you know, as a writer, you're just focused on your work and you're doing what you want to do and need to do. And then it goes out in the world and there's a whole different thing that goes on with it. Yes?
Yeah, people knocking on your door.
Do we have people knocking on our door? Not very much. We have a whole lot of people walking by, taking pictures. They sketch down in the road. We've had people who met in the road get married, which I loved. Occasionally somebody comes up, but mostly... I heard that Peter Mayo had to leave where he was in Provence because so many people bothered him. But I think the people who read my books are nicer than the people who read books. We really enjoyed it. When we're out gardening or we're going into town, we have met a lot of great people from all over the world. So it's been fabulous. Yes.
You mentioned this Italian natural trait of the sweet life of doing nothing. They have a term for that, you mentioned.
Yeah, la dolce vita.
Right. Was that something hard to adjust to, or did you find coming from a small southern town like you did, something that was pretty much similar to what you've known in
the past? He's asking, if you can't hear, did I have trouble adjusting to the kind of la dolce vita, dolce far niente, the kind of sweet life, the sweet to do nothing? I took to it right away. As you mentioned, growing up in the South, I felt immediately a lot of connection with Tuscany because I felt it reminded me so much of the way I grew up in South Georgia. Not that the cultures were similar at all, but just the way of life. You know, it's hot in the summer. They're selling watermelons on the side of the road. Come on over. The open feeling, the hospitality was very, very similar. And the whole dolce far niente is partly a myth, because the Italians, they do work. They get their work done. They just don't obsess over it. They get it done, but they don't live to work. They just work to live. No, they don't work to live. They live.
They
don't live to work. They don't. Anyway. Anything else? Yes.
What does Bramasole mean?
Bramasole is, Bramare is an archaic verb to yearn for. So it means to yearn for the sun, which I just loved the name of it. Because who doesn't yearn for the sun?
Is there still a shrine in the wall?
Yes, there is still a shrine. In the movie, that part was played by a very famous Italian director. And in my book, we never really found out who that was, who brought flowers to the shrine every day. But it's still there. And the nice thing is, I was mentioning people coming from places where my book has been published in different parts of the world. Now, the man with the flowers doesn't come, but these other people do, and they leave coins, they leave the Canadian maple leaf, they leave Christmas ornaments from their hometown, they leave notes. It's just been really a great experience to see how that shrine has taken on a new life. Anything else?
How did you end up in North Carolina?
Oh, how did I end up in North Carolina? Look, I didn't ever introduce Ed, he's right here. The one with the wild brain. We taught at universities in California. We lived in San Francisco forever. And I had a line of furniture with Drexel Heritage in High Point. And I started coming down here to work a lot. We'd been thinking about leaving California. And I had always, in the back of my mind, thought I'd probably love to go back to the South sometime. And so we started coming back down here, and we just absolutely loved coming down. And I still had college friends in the area around Chapel Hill, and
we just decided that we would find ourselves really at home there, and we have.
Closer to Italy.
We bought a farmhouse we've been restoring.
Chapel Hill is the southern part of hell.
Yes.
A book.
Yes, that's right. We actually live in Hillsboro, where a lot of other writers live. Lee Smith, who comes here a lot, lives there, and lots of writers live there. It's a pretty good place. Well, thank you all very much for coming. I enjoyed it so much.